provides several data storage options for you to save persistent application data. This lesson covers an overview of the data storage options to store your application data. Most Android apps need to save data, even if only to save the information about the app state, so the user's progress is not lost. Most apps need to save user settings, and some apps must manage large amounts of information in files and databases. So I will cover some of the data storing options in details, like files, internal external storage, and for some I just cover very quickly, like SQLite database, shared preferences, and other storage options that are available to you as a developer. The later ones have separate chapters, which we will discuss in upcoming sessions. So, first of all, how to store our data for the longer duration of time and make it available for your application to use whenever your application needs it. For that purpose, Android provides a lot of storage options. There are share preferences to store the primitive type of data privately in the key value pairs. Next, we have internal storage to store the data on the device memory to be accessed privately by the application. And external storage option for storing data on the device or on the external media cards, SD cards, that can be accessed by all, that is publicly. This lesson will give you an overview of how to store data, and in upcoming sessions, you will have more details on shared preferences, SQLite databases, and content providers. Apart from these options, Android also provides you to store the data beyond the scope of Android devices. Let's get into this now. There are several ways of storing data of your apps beyond the scope of Android file system. These are few options, like network connection. Android works well with networks. It also makes it easy to connect to various services of your company network, including storage. You can store the data from the server over the network connections. We have cloud backup. You can take up the backup of your app's data or user information in the cloud as well, like on Google Cloud. Information stored in the cloud also means that you won't need to rely on wires to get the information back onto your device. Simply connect with the internet that connects to your cloud server of your choice and bring the data back into your phone. Firebase Realtime Database is a standalone solution for uploading user-generated content like images and videos from your Android mobile devices or from the web. You can store and sync data, which uses NoSQL Cloud Database to save the data in real time across clients. Files. Now let's get started with Android storing arbitrary files in the Android file system. Android uses a file system that is similar to disk-based file systems on the other platforms. So here we will discuss how to work with the Android file system to read and write files with file APIs. All Android devices have two file storage areas, internal and external storage. These names come from the early days of Android, when most devices offered built-in non-volatile memory, that is internal storage, plus a removable storage medium such as micro SD cards, that are external storage. External storage systems consist of public directories, whereas the internal storage contains private directories which are meant to be used by that specific app only. These file APIs are just similar to APIs which you might have used while working with Java I/O. The first one is internal storage. Internal storage is basically the internal memory on the device file system, which is always available. So, you can use this internal storage where you would need to write some kind of file that could be a log file or history file as an isolated storage. And this internal storage gets removed when your application gets uninstalled. So, it's not a permanent storage. Just like internal storage, you have external storage. Except external storage is not going to be available always, as it can be removed. And external storage might be an SD card, or it might be just another section of the device that is designated as external storage. But external storage also allows to have some directories that are Android specific. For example, you could write to a ringtone directory, a specific directory in the Android device, and that could be recognized as a ringtone. Files stored on external storage are world readable, so any app can read it, and you are not going to lose any data even if the app gets uninstalled. Now, the question arises, when to use them? Well, internal is best when you want to make sure that your data should remain private for the app, and it could not be accessible by the user or any other app in the system. And choosing external storage is best for the files that don't require access restrictions, means you don't mind sharing app data with other apps and allows to view these files with the computer as well. In Android, you might want to have some files that can be used by any other applications as well. Generally, new files like images, music, that the user may acquire through your app should be saved to a public location so that other apps can also access them and the user can easily copy them from the device. When doing so, you should use one of the shared public directories, such as music to save your music files and pictures to save your images. Let's see what more we have in internal storage. Each application has its own private internal storage to save the files, and neither other apps nor the user can access them. Files saved in internal storage are accessible only to your app by default with readable and writable permissions. Here, last two lines on the screen shows how you can get the path of the permanent and temporary storage directory. The internal storage is also occasionally referred to as permanent storage. To save files on the internal storage, we need to acquire a directory by calling context getFilesDir. And by calling getCacheDir gets the absolute path of your app's temp cache files. And here is an example shows how a new file can be created by specifying the file and the name of the directory, where the file needs to be created by using the file constructor. You can also use standard Java input-output APIs to read, write, and stream files from the Android file system. Let's check out more about external storage now. We already know how we can save the data on the SD cards, or in some devices, the permanent storage space is divided into internal and external partitions. So even without a removable storage medium, there are always two storage spaces. To access or write to the external storage spaces, you must request the write external storage permission in your manifest file. So this is how you set the permission for write and read permission using user's permission element. Here, we are defining the permissions for write external storage and for read external storage. Before you do any work with the external storage, you need to check if external storage is available for read and write, and you should always call get external storage state to check whether the media is available, as it could be missing, read only, or might be mounted to a computer. For example, here, with this way, you can check the availability. Here, we have listed some of the common external public directories that are Android specific. And we can use them quite often when working with storing files, like different kind of files. So we have directory alarms and directory ringtones for reading or writing audio files for alarms and ringtones. Directory document for reading or writing documents that have been created by the user. Directory download for reading or writing files that have been downloaded by the user. And begin your search for knowing more of these with the links. Android's environments class is used to retrieve the environment folder information. And when we have such files that need to be stored publicly to public external directories, we need to get the path. For this, we use get external storage public to get the different state of the public external storage directory for storing files of a particular type based on the argument passed. And here is an example showing how we can save images in pictures directory. It could be possible that there would be no space left on the device. Say, if you are trying to copy something to an Android device, and if the device internal or external storage is full, you get the IO exception, Java IO exception, which is produced by failed or uninterrupted IO operations. And the reason it may say that there is not enough space on the disk. So to handle the system error message, you should check to see if there is any space remaining on the disk through IO exception. And if you know the size of the file, then there are ways to check the available space on the disk. So to check free space left on the disk, call get free space. Or to get the total disk space, call get total space of Java IO class. In case you don't know how much space is needed for the file, throw a try catch for this IO exception. And be sure to check out these links for more. Sometimes you need to free some space out of the disk. You need to remove some extra files from internal or external storage as well when space needed. To do that, get the file and call delete for deleting the files from external storage, and call delete file method for deleting the file from the internal storage. You don't need to delete user's save file like images or music they might have purchased from some apps. The app's private storage directory and all its content get deleted when the user uninstalls apps. So always remember that do not use private storage directory for the content that belongs to the user. Now let's have a quick overview of shared preferences and SQLite database. Another major storage option that you have in Android is the database. And Android uses a relational SQLite database, which is designed for mobile applications. In Android, using database is ideal when you have thousands of records to be stored by your app, and it is supposed to get saved in a structured way. For example, the contacts. And you might be using the records repeatedly. So using database is a good choice when you have to work with many records. Don't worry, we will be covering this in upcoming session in these chapters in details. So when we talk about preferences in Android, what do we mean? Well, it basically includes the settings of your application. And in Android, this concept is called shared preferences. The idea of shared preferences is that you would basically store small pieces of data. But the only real restriction is that you don't want to store large amount of data when using preferences. Shared preferences really can be thought of as a dictionary or a key value pair. What you're going to do is you are going to have some kind of key, and then you're going to have some kind of value that you're going to store. So, for example, you might have a key being username, and for the value, you might store the user's username. And they would put that in there. And then you could retrieve that value by the key, just like using a dictionary. So for a lot of little pieces of data that you're going to be storing inside your Android application, shared preferences are going to make a lot of sense. And by the way, we have a detailed session covering shared preferences. So you will get to know more about this very interesting concept there. Let's now have a brief introduction about other storage options. Use Firebase to store, share, and sync the data in real time. The data syncs across all the clients and remains available in your device even if your app goes offline. Covering Firebase in this session is quite difficult. You need to check out the link in the bottom of the slides. Firebase provides several features for building powerful mobile apps. Here is a list of specifying some major benefits of using it. As it is hosted in the cloud, the connected apps can easily share and synchronize the data in real time. The data is stored in a JSON format. JSON is a hierarchical key-value data structure, where each key refers to objects that contain values pointing to other objects. JSON data is simply a tree of key value pairs. Another way of storing and retrieving the data through network connections using your own web-based services. With available network, you can easily store the data on the web. You can use this package class for doing it. Explore more about Java network packages from these links. From API level 23, Android provides you the auto backup service that allow you to copy your persistent application data to a remote cloud storage. This allows you to restore the application data and the settings in case the user switches Android devices, reinstalls the application, or performs a factory reset. You just need to customize and configure these settings for auto backup for your application. Hence, no code is required, and this service is absolutely free. Be sure to check out this link for configuring auto backups for your applications. Here, we will discuss the usage of Android Data Backup API for saving and restoring your application data. Data backup is not required to be available on all Android devices, and the actual cloud storage might be customized by the device manufacturer. Therefore, the Android team guarantees no safety for storing that data. If the service is not available on your device, the backup service is not called. Hence, it is still safe to implement this service and run it in on any device. To use the backup service, you need to follow some steps. First, you have to register your application package. Then, the backup agenda and the registration key is entered in the Android manifest.xml file. And then, for saving and restoring your data, you need to extend the backup agent class. And finally, when the data gets changed, you need to request the backups to be taken. For more information and implementation, check out the sample code using the link for backup API and data backup. So here are a few links you can refer to know more about file storage. And these are the links to learn more on taking backups of your data. You can now refer the chapter on getting an overview for storing the data. Hope you enjoyed this session.